Hey guys, Sam Pardee here, and I'm going to be recording some Modern with the Hardened Scales deck that rounded out the third deck in our trio at Grand Prix Detroit that we made the finals of. Matt Nass built this deck, and it was slowly iterated on over about 6 months. This was the first tournament we actually decided to play it at, but we had been working on it for a long time, and it won a European GP, got ninth at another one. It was really cool to see sort of the deck evolve over time. The big innovation that I think we were missing that was sort of the breakthrough at the European GP was adding animation module, which is a pretty nice card. You don't want to draw too many. I think too many of them really bogs down your draws. But the first one is actually pretty darn strong. The combo with it and Ravager is really nice. You get to basically have pay one, put a counter on Ravager because you keep sacking the token you make. And it gives you just some sort of additional staying power and an additional one drop artifact, which is really something that the deck is missing. The curve is a little bit high. You know, if you count Hangerback and Walking Ballistas as twos, you just have a ton of twos and not a lot of ones. So there's really a lot of additional value there. The one difference between my list and Matt's list is that I'm playing with Horizon Canopy, which Matt wasn't able to because it was in Paulo's Bant Spirits deck. I think if you want to play this deck without Horizon Canopy, it's not that big a deal. Playing additional forests is fine. Forests are like fine cards in the deck. Horizon Canopy is probably right, but not that right. So we clearly didn't think it was such a big power level hit to just play with Forest instead of Horizon Canopy, if that's where you're at. So yeah, let's get to some games. All right, here we are for round one. We are on the draw with what I would call a perfectly good hand. We have Hardened Scales into our choice of Ballista or Hangerback, depending on if the matchup is grindy or one where Ballista's powerful. So, yeah, pretty good. So one of the big draws for us towards Hardened Scales was that it has a pretty good matchup against humans. They're not that good against Ballista. They're not that good at interacting with Hangerback Walker. So that was definitely one of the reasons we chose to play the deck. Looks like we're playing against either Storm or maybe Blue-White Control. Which I think both of those are medium matchups. Blue-white is tough because they just have so many ways to interact. Okay, Storm it is. Well, I'm going to play Steel Overseer this turn then. Hope they don't kill us on turn three, but we're very likely dead. If we were on the play, this would have gone a little better. Obviously, we could have played Overseer on turn two. Then they play their Baral. We play Ballista, activate Overseer, kill Baral. And, you know, we're doing just fine, as is, not feeling so hot. Guessing we're going to get whatever we play here remanded, almost certainly. And then they're going to get to loot. But we can't just not play spells. That's not realistic, so. Oh. Okay. Well, that's actually not that big a deal. Because now we can just play the scales again, use Overseer and shoot the Baral to death, unless they have a bolt. They have an opt. Okay, whatever. So yeah, I don't mind trading Ballista for Baral here, I think. Because we have another Ballista anyway, so we just want to slow them down. They have another Baral, perhaps? No, an Electromancer. Okay, well, we've got another Ballista at the ready for that, so that's good news. So I think, yeah, we'll just go Ballista, Overseer, activate, or Ballista, Hangerback, activate, Overseer, kill Electromancer. Hopefully that stops us from dying, and then if we, like, Stirrings into a Ravager, we very likely have lethal. We're just getting into pretty good shape here. And now it's harder, like, having a Ballista on two on board also makes it a little harder for our opponent to go off. Okay, they Noxious Revivaled their Baral. So, does that mean they can go, it must be able to go off this turn then. But it might be a little dicey. Because they might end up tight on mana here. Because we certainly don't care about Empty the Warrens, we can beat that easily. They might just end up with, like, a Grape Shot type thing. Oh, Past in Flames, gonna try again. Okay. Yeah, this is definitely not how most, you know, going offs look, I would say. They might end up grape-shotting some stuff. Okay, so they have gifts, but they can't really gifts for too much that's scary here. Like, they're probably going to gift for grape-shot and some spells and some rituals. Manamorphose is definitely going to be among their finds, I think. I'd be very surprised if they don't choose that one. I'm guessing it's going to be like Manamorphose, grape-shot, and then I really don't know. Some more rituals, maybe? Like Lightning Bolt? So they can deal with Wakibee? Yeah, this is interesting. I'm not sure what they're supposed to get here. Okay, so they just went with Ritual, Manamorphose, Past in Flames. So if we just give them the Ritual, they can go Ritual, Past in Flames, Ritual, Manamorphose, and have a good amount of mana. That'll leave them with too much mana for us to go off through. If we give them Manamorphose Past in Flames, they get to play Manamorphose and try to find a ritual. And then they could go Past in Flames, go off. So if we give them Ritual Past in Flames, then they get to go up to 3 mana. Oh wait, that doesn't even do it. Okay, so yeah, I can just give them Paretic Ritual Past in Flames. I guess if they have a land, they could get us here. But even then, yeah, I think this is probably the safest. So I'm going to put Ritual and Manamorphose in their yard. So we know they have Paretic Ritual, Past in Flames. So they can go up to 3 mana, play Past in Flames, but then they don't have any mana left. So I don't know exactly what they do with that. Okay, they have a land. That was definitely step one for them not losing this turn. Because now they can cast all their rituals and the Manamorphose, and cast the gifts. Yeah, but they've used both their Past in Flames now, so they might end up a little tight on mana. We'll see, I suppose. Because, yeah, they probably can't gift for another Past in Flames. So they can gift for, like, Ritual, Grape Shot, and I'll just give them a Ritual and a Grape Shot, I think. Think that'll put them up to 5 mana, which is enough to go Past in Flames, Ritual, Grape Shot, but not they go Past in Flames, Ritual, Grape Shot, and kill us. So I think we're dead. I guess we have to give them Manamorphose Grape Shot and hope that they brick, but then they can cast 2 cantrips. No, they can cast 3 cantrips and the grape shot, so we're dead. Yeah, alright. That'll do it. Dang, that was pretty close. Yeah, they had to have the land there, which obviously didn't know about. I think we gave ourselves the best chance to win, but who knows. So anyway, out of the board, Damping Sphere and Graft Digger's Cage are good. Dismember is good. Luckily, like most decks, you improve a ton against Storm post-board. That's one of the biggest weaknesses of Storm in my experience, is that they're weak to just about every sideboard strategy. So I like cutting Throne of Geth, and I like cutting down on Animation Module, and took out one Welding Jar, although I think Welding Jar might just be good because you have Damping Sphere. I also like cutting some of the twos. I think Hangerback is the worst one. Although Overseer is not amazing, but... Alright, let's give this a try. Alright, here we are for game 2. We get to go first, but not with this hand, I don't think. Also, it's really annoying how many of our cards are missing art. Like, I get that it's probably a low priority for the people who work on Magic Online, but it's really a horrible look. It makes the cards just look bad. And I think it should be a higher priority to make sure that every card always has art. I find it very frustrating personally. So I think here I actually want to play Damping Sphere because we might draw a land or a mana source. Oh, shoot. Well, that was stupid. I should have played the Mox Opal first. I meant to play Mox Opal Damping Sphere because then if we drew a creature land, getting our Ravager killed wouldn't be that big a deal. Yeah, that was really bad. But anyway, I'm going to go Opal and then play... Can't play Ravager. Really screwing it up here, guys. Sorry about that. I'm going to kill Baral. Man, I'm not good at playing with Damping Sphere in play, clearly. Alright, so we did draw a Nexus, so now we get to play a Ravager and have Nexus to put it on if things go badly. Then we can play another Ravager. And I think we should go ahead and animate Nexus and get in there. And pump... I don't know. I actually think I'm going to not use Pendlehaven, because we could use it to make grape-shotting our Ravagers to death a lot more awkward. So I think I would like to save it for that. Also because we have a Dismember to potentially interact with. I think our opponent's going to cast an End of Turn Gifts here. Let's see what that's all about. Okay, so they just went for the traditional ritual thing. Well, I think I'm going to give them just Paretic Ritual Manamorpho, or Paretic Ritual Past in Flames. Could give them Paretic Ritual Desperate Ritual, but then if they go Baral, they can play them both. That's actually not that bad. Yeah, I guess just giving them... Well, I assume they're going to have to clear out this Damping Sphere as well, so choking them on mana does make some sense. Yeah, I'll bin those two. I have no idea what's right there, but it's a tough spot, obviously. Looks like they have maybe Noxious Revival as well, I would guess. Considering Noxious Revivaling that Brawl, maybe. But they couldn't do it because of Damping Sphere, so there's that. Ooh, a cage is not bad. I'm pretty happy with that. And we'll go Nexus, Animate, and Crunch. And this time I think we should probably use Pendlehaven on something. I guess on the Ink Moth, probably. And then I think I like sacking Opal to Ravager. Yeah. We could also try to go for a kill here with Nexus. We have 5, 6, 7. Oh no, we couldn't even. We have 8 total Nexus damage available to us, because we can sack Ravager to Ravager and Modular onto the Nexus. But next turn, if they tap out, we do actually have a potential lethal there. Okay, so they're gonna go for Repeal on Damping Sphere. I think we should sack it to a Ravager, just to deny them a card. Because it's going to be tough for them to go off without playing a Mana Dork first anyway. So I want to make that as close to reality as possible. And I think we're going to try to kill them with an Ink Moth next turn anyway, because we can do so through a Bolt or removal spell of some kind. Alright, there's the Baral. So now I'm going to respond to the first spell I'm allowed to with a Dismember. Maybe not that one, because they can just cast all their rituals in response right away. So I'll wait on that. This doesn't really choke them on mana too much, because yeah, they can still just cast another ritual in response. And have a decent amount of mana. But I don't know if they can actually go off super hard here. They can play the Past in Flames, then go Ritual up to 3, Ritual up to 4. So they'll have 4 mana, 5 mana counting the Sheevan Reef to work with. I don't know if that'll be good enough. Oh, I miscounted. I missed something. Okay, they have... Yeah, I guess they just have a Grape Shot and that's lethal. Yeah, All right. Well, good beats. We got beaten pretty badly there. We'll be back for round two. All right, here we are for round two. We get to go first. This hand's a little sketchy, but I like keeping hands that have hardened scales plus ancient stirrings or something else to do. I think this is likely enough to find us, you know, whatever piece we need, that it's a good keep. Ooh, a little mirror action. All right, I'm into that. So I think I actually want to go ahead and play the Throne of Geth here rather than stirrings, because whatever we stirrings for, we're unlikely to be able to cast. And if we draw a land next turn, then we can stir for like a Ballista and play it right away, which is pretty big. Okay, they're playing a Steel Overseer, which is definitely a great card in the mirror, but we drew a good one. A good way to handle a Steel Overseer, that's for sure. Opponent is playing with Ruins of Oren Reef, which was a card that we tried in this deck and were pretty unimpressed with, ultimately. It just did not feel powerful enough to be worth it. Okay, so we're going to end of turn sack Welding Jar to Throne of Geth here and proliferate our Ballista up to 3. Choose not to proliferate their Arcbound Worker, I think, is probably the right choice. And now we have the option to kill that Arcbound Worker whenever we want. Ooh, a Worker is pretty nice. So I think I'm just going to stir to start this turn off. Let's see what we get. A Ravager, that's exactly what we're looking for. Ballista is a pretty dominant force in this matchup, for sure. So now we can go ahead and attack with Ballista. And I think we should just go ahead and sack the Worker. There's nothing in game one that can really punish us for it. We could sack something else, and then we get an extra proliferate first, but this is going to be more than enough when all is said and done. So we'll just nug them for 8 and then kill their Worker. I guess there's no real reason to do it now. The potential reason to do it now would be because we're worried about them drawing like an Ink Moth Nexus that they could play and put counters on with the Worker, but we can just kill it again with the Ballista because we have plenty of counters. So yeah, writing's on the wall there. Oops. Yeah, we got them. So sideboarding in the mirror is Nature's Claim, I believe, is good. Dismember, I believe, is good. Evolutionary Leap, I believe, is bad. I'm really not sure what to take out. I think Steel Overseer might not be the best because it is so vulnerable to Walking Ballista, but it is also one of those cards that has like really high upside. When it works, it's just the best thing ever. So I'm not totally sure. I think an animation module, actually both the modules, seem like a pretty safe cut. I think the match is going to be determined by somebody going really big with a Walking Ballista more than anything else. I guess Throne of Geth is probably safe, and then one Overseer. I think Welding Jar is good because of Nature's Claim. I think that probably changes the dynamic enough that it's worth keeping in, but maybe we could cut one and keep one Throne. That seems scientific. Let's do that. All right, here we are for game two. We're on the draw, but clearly not with this hand. Yeah, it's not a great one, but we'll keep it. Send that guy to the bottom. All right, turn one scales. Okay, that was a good draw. So now we have turn one scales. I guess there's no real reason to play the jar. I was thinking maybe we should, but yeah, there's no point. We can play the jar on our next turn. They have the Ballista? No, it's just a hanger back. Okay, so they don't have the most explosive draw either. We can go Nexus, Opal, Jar, Worker. I should have done that in the other order. I should have done Hanger Back, then Worker, but that's fine. I mean, I guess we're insulated from Nature's Claim anyway. We would just use the Jar. Okay, so it looks like they have no plays. That's definitely good news for us. So we can play another Worker. And Should we attack with our worker is the question. I think we should, because it gives us a chance to put counters on a Nexus if they block, and I'm pretty happy with that. So they're going to block and then charge, and we'll go ahead and fire the counters off onto Nexus. Nope. Change their minds, which I believe is wise. I think blocking there would have been probably advantageous for us. Okay, immediately cycle away Horizon Canopy. So I think this game is very likely that whoever finds either a Ravager or a Ballista first is going to be in really good shape. Oops, I hit F4 thinking that I would get priority again, but that didn't end up happening. So that was kind of loose. I missed a charge on my hangar back. Although, again, I don't think that's super likely to matter unless we like both draw Ravagers at the same time. I think it's just going to be whoever draws one of those cards wins. These workers are not too bad, though. They actually just let us beat our opponent up, which is kind of nice. We just get to keep crunching with them. Because if they block, they give us a big Nexus advantage. Okay. The Blink Moth means that their Ink Moth is now unblockable functionally because of... Well, that's not strictly true. We could still just block, but I don't think we should. If we blocked, they could pump, and then theirs would live, but it would die if they ever activated it again. So that would not probably be fine. That would actually be just fine for us. Oh, wow, they're going to pump? I think this is a fairly aggressive pump, because now it means that they can't block in the face of a Ravager, potentially. Unless they maybe it indicates that they have a removal spell. It's a very real possibility. Anyway, we'll charge our hangar back. Oh, this is going to get them to do some action. They're going to blow up our hangar back. I think we're just good with that. I think that's just okay for us. I just let that happen, I believe. Yeah. We could obviously welding jar to save it, but I just don't think I care very much. I think I would rather save... Well, what else is the welding jar doing for us? I think just getting 2/1/1 flyers might actually be great, though. Yeah, I'm just going to let that happen. Because we're kind of beating down now. Okay, Pendlehaven ain't bad either. So now I think we just attack with everything? Including Ink Moth? No, not including Ink Moth, because we want to block if they draw Ravager, I think. So we maybe should leave one Thopter back as well. This is two-turn lethal anyway, so it's fine. And yeah, it makes blocking pretty tough for them. We get to put 3 counters onto our Thopter here. And I guess Pendlehaven it as well. I guess we might as well put the counters on untapped Thopter. Yeah, sure. That makes some sense. And yeah, now our opponent is in a lot of trouble just to what we have going on. I don't know exactly what their hand is. I can't really figure it. They're going to keep shipping that Ink Moth, which I guess we block. I mean, I'll trade Thopter for two +1/+1 counters. That sounds like a pretty positive trade. Huh. I guess they just, yeah, I assume their hand was bad, but it didn't seem like... I don't really understand why they attacked. So we were going to draw Stirrings into Ravager, which was going to be lethal. So there you have it. We'll be back for round 3. All right, here we are for round 3. We're on the draw, and I also have a pretty good estimation that we're playing against Mardu Pyromancer, and this hand looks pretty good against Mardu Pyromancer to me. Our opponent is Selfiesek, who is... I would say is the person who put the Mardu Pyromancer deck on the map, is how I would describe them. They just played it a ton, and have typically are in the trophy leader for Modo and so on and so forth. So a little scouting, if you will, although not didn't really affect our decision. I think we would have kept this hand against an unknown opponent just as well as we would have kept it specifically against Mardu Pyromancer. But against Mardu, Hangerback is one of your better cards. In the post-board games, they sometimes have... Well, that's nice. Getting Thoughtseize and then immediately drawing the card they took. The post-board games, they sometimes muck around with cards like Stony Silence, so it's good to have outs to that. I think here, I don't actually mind letting them have a turn of Young Pyromancer. It's not that big a deal. Like Lingering Souls. Colligan's Command to destroy and... Okay, that was a pretty clever play. They get to keep us from getting a token. Or a +1/+1 counter, rather. So let's go ahead and stir. Ugh, I don't love any of these options. I think... Welding Jar is probably the best. Them on the bottom and then play Jar Ballista and bash for one. I think we'll let them keep the Pyromancer a little bit longer, because if we draw another land we can go like Ballista Throne and proliferate, and then we don't have to lose our Ballista. They have land, Lingering Souls. That's all fine. Ballista is actually pretty nice against Lingering Souls, really. Okay, well, a Worker's pretty good, actually. So we'll go Throne, Worker. We'll see if they do anything to the, for the, in response to the Throne. Then play the Worker. And then we can sack... We can sack the Worker onto the Thopter and proliferate it, which kills both of the spirits. Alternately, we could just sack the Thopter and proliferate and get our Worker up to 2. I think that's actually probably better here, so I'm going to start with that. And then kill off this Pyromancer before things get too far out of hand. Yeah, I'm feeling not too bad about where we're at in this game. Of course, it only takes a Bedlam Reveler to put us into bad shape. We've got another Ballista ready to go. So hopefully we draw like an Opal or a Darksteel Citadel, something we can sack to Throne after playing Ballista for 2. That would be nice. They're going to try to Helix that. I think we'll just Welding Jar. That's fine. Would prefer to keep our Ballista around for the time being. They might have double removal spell, which would be a little bit annoying, but what can you do? They have another Colligan's Command. That's bad news. And it looks like that's what's up. That's annoying. No? Maybe they're rethinking it. They're going to attack first, of course, because we're going to shoot down a spirit token otherwise. That is a good play. And now they're going to kill both of our creatures. Yeah, getting double Colligan's Commanded is rough, for sure. Oh, they're going after the Throne here. Okay, interesting. So we get to keep the Worker around. So we can go Ballista for 1 and attack with Worker. I think we want to race damage here, so that's fine. Because we can always use the Ballista to clear off pressure later if we need to. Ugh, stop it. All right, kill a spirit. Ooh, Steel Overseer is a good draw for sure. So, yeah, now I'm going to hang back because putting two counters on Steel Overseer is not even very appealing. So hopefully they brick for a turn here and we get to jam a Ballista. Oh, dear. I don't know what this attack means, but I don't love it. Oh. Okay, apparently it doesn't mean anything. So we'll Stirrings, I think just into a Nexus, because then we can play Ballista and activate our Nexus. No, that's loose. Should be a Ravager, I think. Then we'll play this Ballista for one. Yeah, Ravager's just too good, I think, to pass up here. Do that. Crunch in. And I think we are going to win now. I'm going to kill one of these tokens just to stay above six, because I think that's sort of the magic number, of course. That was a good draw. So we could go for a kill here. I think we just should. It's really unlikely our opponent has something that they were waiting on. So what we're going to do is put counters here. Once the counters land, kill that. And then we can... Yeah, we actually have a really trivial kill here, of course. All right. Well, that was a hard-fought game one. Pretty close. So sideboarding, they sometimes have things that Nature's Claim is good against. Karn and Evo Leap are definitely great. And I think Throne of Geth is not very good. In matchups where your opponent's killing a lot of your stuff and breaking up your synergies, Throne of Geth tends to get a little worse. I also think Steel Overseer is not great in this matchup, but it's okay. I don't think Tormod's Crypt is good enough to actually want. If we had a cycling card like Relic of Progenitus, I'd be about that. But I think Tormod's Crypt is too costly. Like, we go down a whole card to fight their graveyard, and that is valuable. That has value. And it's good against Bedlam Reveler, but yeah, I think it's just too inefficient. I could see bringing in one, though. Yeah, I'm going to try one for... I'll try one for a Steel Overseer. I really don't want to draw two in a game. I think that would be a disaster. I'm not even sure I want to draw one, but we'll try it. I'm not going to bring in Nature's Claim until I see for sure that our opponent has Stony Silence. And this is one of the matchups you can win through Stony Silence thanks to our Artless Evolutionary Leap. So, yeah, let's give this a try. All right, here we are for game two. We're on the draw, and this hand looks like a sure keep to me. We have turn one Steel Overseer with double Welding Jar backup. So if our opponent doesn't have a hand disruption spell on turn one, we're just going to wreck them. If they do, things get a little more awkward, but it'll still be a tough choice for them what to take, I think. And they do. But, like, it's so tough if they're supposed to take the Opal or the Overseer or even the Ravager, I think are all really strong cards with two Welding Jars to protect them. I think if I was in my opponent's position, depending, of course, on what their hand is, but I think my default would be to just take the Opal and hope that, you know, mana screws me. Of course, we found an Ancient Stirrings, which I'm going to cast right now because I want to avoid potentially getting destroyed by another hand disruption spell, not letting us play our cards. And then I think I'm just going to hold the Welding Jars. They can take one away from us if they want. Ooh. All right, well, I'm just going to play Overseer plus some jars now. And then next turn we can go Ballista, activate, kill off that young Pyromancer, and yeah, things should be good. I guess they could go with like an upkeep destroying Steel Overseer thing. That's maybe something they might do. Ooh, the temptation to block here is a little bit strong. Block and regen. If they have two removal spells, it goes pretty badly for us, though, so it's probably not worth it. Steel Overseer is just so powerful if it lives that I want to try to maximize the odds of that. Okay, we've made it through to our turn, and they're going to indeed try to mess with our Steel Overseer. So what we could do is animate Nexus and activate Overseer and regenerate it, or we could just regenerate it and activate it. basically it's a question of if we brick on lands. If we brick on lands, we would have preferred, of course, to not activate it. I think we're doing well enough that we can afford to miss our land drop here and still have a good chance to win. So I'm just going to regenerate and then do that. Well, we found the land, so punished, I suppose. But that's okay. I'll go module Ravager. Playing the Ravager here over the Ballista because it gives us both the best protection against Forked Bolt, which I think might be relevant, and also gives us the best chance to play a Ballista for two next turn, potentially, which could matter. This is going to be a wear tear, probably. Yeah, going after the Ravager. So I think I'm just going to let this go, actually, and put the counter on Overseer. We could also sack Animation Module first and make a 4-4 Overseer, which gets out of the range of a lot of our opponent's potential interaction, and would really make it tough for them to have enough things to kill the Overseer. It's a tough choice. I think we can win without the Animation Module, so I'm going to do that. Okay, so now, do we want to animate the Ink Moth this turn? I think we do. Yeah, I think I'll go animate Ink Moth, use Overseer, and regen Overseer. Now we'll just get that Ballista down. Still think it's probably right to not activate it. Yeah, I think that's probably better because we're just going to get... We have 4 mana. We can charge it. Oh, well, maybe it's dying anyway. Oh, no, our Ink Moth is. That probably implies that our opponent has another removal spell and that we should have just killed Young Pyromancer, but I really don't know. Okay, so they're going to loot... And then probably have a Bedlam to follow it up with, would be my guess. Loot away some hand disruption. Oh, and just a land. Okay. Well, that ain't bad. So they can looting again, but that's not a huge deal. Yeah, we can take this. That's fine. We might end up dying to burn spells here. It's possible, but I'm going to try my best to not let that happen. I think we should go ahead and cycle Horizon Canopy now. And just pass. Then we can, yeah, we can do some... We can do some decent work here. Yeah, they get to looting. That's fine. So if they attack with everything, we'll go worker on Pyromancer, block 2 tokens, activate, then put the worker counters onto Walking Ballista, and then we should be stable. And they can't really attack with less than everything, I don't think. I think that's probably pretty bad. I guess they could attack with all the non-Pyromancer stuff, but then we just eat 3 tokens and go to 3, which obviously we could end up getting burnt out here. That's part of the range, but I hope it doesn't happen. Ooh, Hardened Scales. I think that is better to play than the Hangerback this turn. Gives us just as much blocking equity. Yeah, we probably still don't get to attack. I think we should go ahead and kill the Pyromancer now, though, just to avoid any unpleasantness. All right, I don't think we were done there. I don't think we had actually won that game just because our life total was so low. We could easily get burned out. But it was going to be really hard for our opponent to deal us a lot more damage over the course of the game, and we were probably going to be able to grind them out. So there we go. We'll be back for round number 4. All right, here we are for round 4. We get to go first. Yeah, this looks like a keep to me. Welding Jar plus Steel Overseer is a pretty powerful combination. And even if it takes, you know, even if it's not turn 1, getting to do that on turn 2 is pretty nice. And the rest of the hand is good. Like, we're pretty resilient to a lot of stuff, so I'm good with it. I think I'm actually going to go ahead and play the Welding Jar here, because I would be kind of annoyed if it got taken by a Thoughtseize or an Inquisition. There's obviously some other considerations to think about, like Burning Inquiry, but I think Thoughtseize and Inquisition are the most likely. You know? That's making Burning Inquiry look more likely, but we'll see. Could also be Death Shadow. Nah, that's feeling like a, oh, well, they did have Thoughtseize. Okay, so maybe Death Shadow then. I'm not sure. Hangerback usually incredible against Death Shadow decks. Just very hard for them to deal with, and then the Thopters really matter because they put themselves at such a low life total. Ballista's also really good, actually. All of the 2-mana cards are really good against them. Back when Eldrazi Tron used to be a deck, Hangerback was a card that I really liked against Death Shadow matchups. Alright. So we lose our Hangerback. Hangerback is also really good against Hollow One, if that's what we are, in fact, playing against. So a land is actually a pretty good draw here because it lets us go Ballista, make a thing, and then put counters and get a counter on our guy. On our animation module created creature. And I am pretty happy about our decision to play Welding Jar. Like, if our opponent just had a Fatal Push or something, I think they might have taken Welding Jar from us and that would have been a little bit annoying. Verdant Catacombs. Okay, that implies to me maybe a Death Shadow deck that is not Grixis. Like maybe like a Traverse Death Shadow deck. That's kind of where I'm at now, if I had to guess. Which means Teemer Battle Rage a little more of a concern. Stuff along those lines. So I'm guessing this is going to be the upkeep Abrupt Decay or Steel Overseer play. Or, you know, some kind of removal spell on Steel Overseer. And yeah, we'll regenerate that. I think there's not much downside to that. No need to create the animation module token here, because we could draw something like Hardened Scales or something that causes us to do a play different than creating the token. But now that we did not draw anything, we'll just play Ballista for one, plus a token. This does play right into Culligan's Command, which would be really annoying. So hopefully that doesn't happen to us. Otherwise, we should be in good shape to sort of take over the game. If we get to Steel Overseer with 4 mana up, we'll get to make 3 tokens with Animation Module. And then we should be able to just swarm through our opponents. You know, they've dealt themselves a total of 10 damage here. We should be able to just swarm through. Okay, Death Shadow confirmed, for sure. Tarfire is pretty much a dead giveaway. But we have some play here. Is this going to be a Traverse? Yeah, okay. What's that get for you? Tarmogoyf would be massive at this point. It would be just missing enchantment. Traverse for basic forest. And then dismember our ballista. I think we should just go ahead and shoot in response. It seems like our opponent is low enough that we might conceivably actually kill them here. Alright. Ink Moth was not the kind of Nexus I would have preferred. Blink Moth would have been better. But we'll attack for them down to 4. Ravager would have been the best draw because we would have won the game on the spot. Alright, there's a Death Shadow. That's scary stuff. And a Grim Flare with Kicker enabled. Okay, Hangerback's a good draw, so we'll just play that for 2 and make a servo. That's good. And now that really puts the pressure on our opponent to kill us, because otherwise we'll eventually just win with our stuff. Okay, so now they can put themselves very low. And we might just be dead to Teemer Battle Rage. They go down to 1, and Teemer Battle Rage. Yep, that's 24, and we only have 4 power to block with. And they also have 4 more, so it's 28 total. Alright, well, didn't quite come together quite quickly enough, but it was close. So sideboarding. I think Tormod's Crypt actually is good enough here, because we can hit it with a traverse on the stack, so that's fine. I'm gonna board out Throne of Geth and Leap. Although Leap is not horrible. I think 1 dismember is nice, although it's artless for some reason. So yeah, let's give this a try. Alright, here we are for game 2. We get to go first. Yeah, this hand looks acceptable to me. It's not amazing, but it's fine. I think we go turn 1 jar plus stirrings here. Stirrings. I believe we should just take this other Ravager, because Ravagers are great. You can never really have too many Ravagers. And I'm guessing we're going to get a turn 1 hand disruption spell played against us, because that's kind of the way these things go. Oh no, turn 1 traverse for a basic. Okay. That's nice. So we'll get to play a Ravager onto an empty. Oh well, I'm going to play Overseer instead, actually. I don't mind that at all. I'm guessing this will get killed during our upkeep. Probably. I should have actually played the Nexus here, I think. Oh, Grudge? Yeah, still worth regenerating from, I think. Yeah, I should have played the Nexus, I think, and given it a counter here. Actually, that could have been relevant. But we drew Hardened Scales, so we got bailed out. Alright, well, we're going to have to battle through this Ancient Grudge, which is usually tough, but in this spot I actually think we're in okay shape to do so. Especially because our opponent is constrained. The way that their mana set up is not great. I think they would prefer to have like a forest and a blood crypt if they had these colors, because then they could cast Grudge and a non-red removal spell, because the red removal spells are not really going to be that effective against a Ravager. Like, I guess they could just Grudge the Ravager and then Bolt Seal Overseer if they have that. If they have the Tarfire type effect. Yeah, so maybe I'm wrong. Maybe it doesn't matter that much. We also, of course, have a really good shot at putting together a kill next turn, depending on what they're up to. Especially if we draw a land. If we can go Ravager plus Ballista, we can maybe make some fireworks happen. Okay, so that makes it pretty clear they don't have a red-based removal spell, because I think they would have done it in the other order if they did. Yeah. Okay, so now we can go... If we just go Ravager and then sack Ravager to Ravager, that puts this one up to 9. Then we can go 10, 11, 12, 13 counters. So that's not really doing it. We could play Ballista, sack Citadel, hit for 6, and then hit, or sack Citadel and Nexus, hit for 8, and then move all the counters to the Ballista. But that could lose to Dismember, which... is a definitely a plausible card for our opponent to have in this spot. So I think what I'm going to do instead is just play this Overseer and hit for 4 with Ravager. Because we're still going to have the Ballista, you know, attempted Ballista kill option available to us in the future. So I think it's fine to just take it a little slower here. See where things lead. Okay, so pretty unlikely now that they have Dismember, I think. I guess I should actually play this other Ravager first. I'll go Ravager, then Ballista, then use Overseer. I should have tapped differently, though. I think I should have tapped Citadel, because then we could have still been... If they tapped out to, like, Ancient Grudge, Steel Overseer, we could have still been threatening to kill with Ink Moth. Although, I think at this point, killing is actually going to be trivial if this Ballista resolves. We'll be able to build we'll be able to hit with Ravager, and if they ever tap out for anything, we'll just make this Ballista lethal-sized. All right, so that was a nice one. For game 3, I think I like how we sideboarded. Could imagine bringing in the other Dismember, but I don't think that's really necessary. Yeah, let's just run it. All right, here we are for game number 3. We are on the draw. This hand is not ideal. It's going to have a kind of a tough time battling through an Ancient Grudge, but on the other hand, it also has Ravager, which is our best card, and Ancient Stirrings, which is our second best card. So I'm going to keep it. Alright, so this is the full, what I would call the full Traverse Death Shadow experience here. Look at the top card of Mishra's Bauble, draw it with Street Wraith, crack a fetch, etc., etc. And looks like Traverse for a basic, and get Delirium online. So a pretty darn good opening from our opponent. Ooh, but we drew Hardened Scales on turn 1. I'm just going to slam that. Better to play than Animation Module, I think. Yep, turn 2 Grim Flayers. Pretty nice for our opponent. Play a Ravager and cross our fingers that things go well. But yeah, being on the draw against, you know, a turn 2 fully powered Grim Flayer is not a great spot to be. It's going to be a Liliana or something. I guess Liliana would be beatable, actually. Wouldn't be the end of the world. Tarfire. Annoying. Yeah, that's definitely the punishment we get for not having a ton of artifacts to start with. If we draw an Opal, that would be nice. We could go Opal Ravager, or Opal Module Ravager, and then make a servo immediately and have just like a nice, relatively wide board. I think that would give us a really good chance to be competitive. Oof, they only put one card into the graveyard from Grimflare. Then add a gigantic Tarmogoyf. Pretty scary. Alright, well, we'll go Module Ravager here, and that way it's at least safe from Tarfire. Although, you know, I'm guessing they put something better than Tarfire on top of their deck, like Teemer Battle Rage probably beats us, because I'm certainly not going to block either of these things. Yeah, there's a lot of ways we lose, but if we're completely undisrupted here, we have a decent chance of getting an Ink Moth Nexus kill set up, but I suspect we're going to get Ancient Grudged. Yeah. Yep. This hand was going to be weak to Ancient Grudge, and our opponent's draw on top of the Ancient Grudge was also excellent, so I think this is probably not even a great matchup, I would guess. This kind of deck is usually pretty good at picking synergies apart, and our deck is definitely a synergy-based kind of deck. All right, let's see what we can stir into. I guess Arcbound Worker is the best we're going to do. So I'm going to play Opal, then play Worker plus Pendlehaven, and use the Opal to pay for the animation module ability. Although they might grudge module in response, perhaps. Then we never get the Opal online. We'll see. Oh wow, they didn't even want to use the flashback on Grudge. Okay. Does that beat us? I guess it doesn't strictly beat us. We can use Ink Moth to block Tarmogoyf. Maybe. Pretty good chance that just beats us, but I guess we'll see. So any burn spell, any removals. Oh, I guess they just have a grudge in the yard. Yeah, okay, we're dead. All right, well, good beats. Hopefully we can get the last one. We'll be back for round 5. All right, here we are for round 5. We get to go first. I do like gambling on one landers, but this one might not be good. This one I think is actually good enough. Yeah, I'm going to keep it. This hand has enough powerful stuff going on that I think we can miss for a turn and still be okay. So I'm going to keep it. We also have Opal as an out, as counting as a second land functionally. So I think that also pushes me a little towards wanting to keep. All right, looks like we're up against KCI, which is not a great matchup. They're a little bit faster, and you don't have a lot of cards that they have to care about too much. Also, EE is pretty strong against you, and we bricked on lands, so probably going to die. But I think, actually, this is the kind of hand you want against KCI, because this hand has a decent potential of killing really quickly. And also you have a lot of sideboard cards for KCI, of course. Okay, I thought that we were going to get EE'd for one here and then exploded, and that that was going to be kind of annoying, but it looks like that's not what's happening. They're just trying to set themselves up to combo off. EE for zero coming down. Interesting. What's that going to do? I guess just enable Metalcraft is what that's going to do. So, I mean, we are at the point where we're very, very likely to die to a KCI if they have one. But we also can probably set up... Well, I was going to say we can probably set up a kill, but we needed to draw a land there. So we could get the Walking Ballista or Ravager into play. And then the Walking Ballista is also nice because it would have been a little bit of disruption in that it stops stops Scrap Trawler from living. But they also might not have a KCI yet. All we can do is cross our fingers and hope. Yeah, all right. Ichor Wellspring implies no KCIs yet. And if we draw a, let's see, if we draw a Darksteel Citadel, we can play a Ravager for two, sack this, that's six with five here, seven, eight. So we can do 13. Yeah, so we don't, can't quite get there. If we had a Ravager, like I said, if we had a Ravager or a Ballista already in play, then we would be off to the races and we'd be pretty much golden. But as is, I think we're just going to have to hope for a brick, a few more bricks. At this point, it's also almost 100% that we would die if they find the KCI. All right, there's the land, so that's good. So I'm going to play... Well, actually, this EE does maybe mean we shouldn't play Ballista here. I guess I can just regenerate it, and it might be... It might offer some disruption. It's kind of unlikely that it offers much, because I think we're so likely to lose if they find a KCI. But we're also going to win next turn if they don't kill us. So that's all good. Okay, Scrap Trawler, very beatable. Very, very beatable. And tapped out. All right, so we win. Nice. Just took, basically took us hitting their fail rate. That's all. Sure, Terrarian's fine. We can definitely go ahead and play Ravager. And then I think we go ping Scrap Trawler for one. Yeah, this looks like an easy enough kill. Do that, do that. This seems like the simplest way to do it to me. I don't know. There's probably a kill that plays around some zero mana spell that there's almost no chance our opponent has in their deck, but this one is nice and simple anyway, so... Yeah, I mean, this is super easy. All right, well, definitely feels like we stole one there, and the post-board games are much kinder to us. We get to bring in Damping Sphere and Nature's Claim and cut all of our sort of grindy stuff, Leap, Throne of Geth. I think Welding Jar is actually still pretty good, because they have to kill all of our stuff individually. They have to kill, you know, they have to use removal on the... They have to use, like, a Nature's Claim or an EE to kill the Damping Spheres. So, like, they're still pretty good. Cut a Worker for sure. Not really sure what else to cut. I guess we can cut down on Hangerback a little bit, because it's not great. But I think the rest of our cards are kind of great. We could cut one Welding Jar. It's a little dicey. But Damping Sphere is also, like, not that insane. It's not that impossible for them to win through it. It's pretty good, though. Yeah, this looks reasonable to me. Let's give this a try. Alright, here we are for game number two. We're on the draw, and this hand looks fine to me. I think it's a keep. Nothing incredible, but just fine. Yeah, we'll lead with turn one Hardened Scales. I'm guessing it's going to get Nature's Claimed, because our opponent played the Opal that way. No, okay. Kind of thought that was going to be a given. Our opponent is on a very explosive opening, so we'll see. Probably not going to be able to avoid tapping out next turn, but we could definitely just die. Definitely part of the range. But yeah, I really want to get the Steel Overseer into play. I think it's just such high upside to do so. Even though there is a chance we just die now. I think this gives us the highest chance to win. Because even from here, they might not have enough gas left to kill us. Even though I think it's pretty likely they have KCI, because they didn't play any 1-drops off that Mox Opal for multiple turns. Okay, just a Psy. I am not particularly afraid of Psy, actually. I don't think it's going to do all that much. So we'll go ahead and play Hangy Bee. And I think just pass. Because now getting to use Nature's Claim might actually be a big game. And also, animate Ink Moth and activate Steel Overseer end of turn is also a relatively big game. Okay, so there's the KCI coming down. And there's no reason to respond to this. I can wait and see what they do before I commit. Now we should go ahead and claim. So if they have another KCI, we'll probably lose, because they're going to get to go pretty deep. I guess if they just have another KCI, it's not the end of the world, because they still have to sack the Scrap Trawler to get anything back. If they have, like, another Ichor, then we're in bad shape. Or another Trawler. Okay, yeah, there's another Ichor. So I am going to scoop when I feel like our opponent has us beat. But right now I think there's a very non-zero chance of them fizzling. Although they have a land drop available as well, so that's obviously going to be tough. I am going to use Steel Overseer so we can have 6, because I don't think that there's much need to do otherwise. Okay, yep, this is a loop. Mirror Retriever, Scrap Trawler, 1-drop, and Psy is actually going to do it with an Opal. Alright, well, we got beaten on turn 3 through a Nature's Claim. So, I think I like how I sideboarded. The Welding Jar might actually be good. And Hangerback might not be. Yeah, I really don't want to draw 2 Hangerbacks. Okay, let's give this a try. Alright, here we are for game 3. We get to go first, but not with this hand. I guess this hand is acceptable. It's not great. Definitely going to bottom Nature's Claim. I think we have enough disruptive elements here that I want to make sure that we can actually win the game through like a Sigh or something like that. And I'm going to lead on Horizon Canopy plus Welding Jar. I don't want to get messed up with Welding Jar Damping Sphere, even though I know it's kind of unlikely that that happens. And then we'll play a Ballista for one. I want to get the Ballista beatdowns going as early as possible, and I don't think there's going to be much need for a Damping Sphere this early in the proceedings. Like, I think if we draw a land next turn, I would even just pump Ballista rather than deploy Damping Sphere. Alright, so now we know our opponent has a KCI, but they don't seem particularly close to doing anything with it, for the time being anyway. Ooh, a Ravager, I like that. Definitely in on playing that and bashing for one. Okay, EE for zero. I guess it's not that annoying. It kills our Welding Jar, and we sack the Opal to Ravager and regenerate Ballista. So it does, it definitely, you know, gets us a little bit, but it's not the end of the world. So yeah, we'll sack Opal, and then regenerate Ballista, I think, is the best line here. And they're going to claim the Ballista. I guess we'll just sack it to Ravager. Definitely would prefer to play a second Ravager here. They have a KCI we know about, but they can play it with nothing in play. That's not a huge deal. And this way, if they have another Nature's Claim, it protects our Ravagers from that. So we don't lose all the counters we've built up. Ooh, Ballista is also really good now because it protects us from EE for two. And yeah, they're still pretty far away from doing anything too nasty. Let's see. So we could hit for up to six here if we sack Ravager to Ravager and Modular there and then sack Citadel. That would be six damage, and then we can put it to move seven counters onto the Ballista, which is not lethal, so not worth doing just yet. But next turn, we can definitely go in a little bit. Alright, Scrappy T seems extremely beatable. Mox Opal's good. So now we can go another Ravager, or are we supposed to just jam this sphere? I guess we could also Nature's Claim the Scrap Trawler, which turns off the Mox Opal, but gets our opponent back the EE. Actually, yeah, I guess... And that puts them up to 16, which is out of kill shot range, because we can go sack Ravager to Ravager, sack Citadel, and try to do it, but it's not enough. So I guess what we do here is just attack with everything. To start with, yeah, that sounds right. Just send in the clowns. And we can grow whatever gets blocked to be big enough to not die, although I suspect they have a Nature's Claim. I actually don't mind all that much if that's what ends up happening. Like, I'm just going to sack this Ravager to this Ravager and move the counters to Ballista. Well, that leaves us so vulnerable to engineered explosives, though, doesn't it? Yeah, this might not have been the best thing. Yeah, I guess I'm just going to sack here and go here. Huh. Maybe they don't have Nature's Claim. We should have just gone bigger. Yeah, I'm just gonna go all in on the Ballista here. This I think I did this in kind of a bad way, but here we are now. I think I should have played something pre-combat, but we'll see what they get back with this. Yeah, so they're going to get back EE, and then I think I should just play Damping Sphere. They can EE for zero and blow it up, but then they'll lose their Opal, and they'll lose their Opal, and it takes their whole turn, so it's not too bad. They probably can't combo us with KCI from here, because they need a fourth land to start to even play anything. If they EE for two, then they just die to the Ballista, and it seems pretty clear they don't have another Nature's Claim. So yeah, I guess this is fine. It's a little bit dicey. I think that last turn, probably it would have been better to play a Ravager pre-combat rather than do what we did. Okay, so now they have KCI mana available, but then they only have 5 mana from Opal, tapping Opal for mana, Sacket, and Ichor, and then their spells cost 1 more, so it's going to be really tough to go off with that. But they're going to try, it looks like. I guess if they have Nature's Claim for Sphere right away, but even still, it'll cost them 2 mana, and then they'll just have 3 left over, and they have to sack the Opal first, so they won't be able to play anything particularly quickly. And we still do have Ballista to kill a potential Scrap Trawler, which is additional disruption, of course. I guess they could also now just go E for zero and use it. But then we just untap, claim that Ironworks, and move on with our lives. Okay, so they are playing E for zero. But then if they use it, their next spell costs plus 2 mana. So they can't even play anything. I guess they could play a potentially another Opal, but we'll go ahead and nug them for 6 to start. All right, well, I think it's better to just get Ravager into play. It means with any cheap card we can kill next turn, and it's going to be pretty tough for them to go off through Sphere. EE for 2 would be completely devastating, but that's where we're at. Okay, Scrap Trawler definitely is beatable. Does let them recur EE, but then it will leave them with just two scrap trawlers left in their deck, and we can obviously kill the KCI. Okay. Ooh, Scales is a very interesting draw here. We could just jam it, and then they have to block Ravager. We sack like Citadel. Then they get back EE, play it for two, pop it. But that uses up their whole turn. Kind of. I guess they have, yeah, they have KCI, it's just so much mana. So what are we supposed to do here? This is tough. Because that Scrap Trawler just lets them recur EE at will. I guess. I mean, they do seem to be somewhat low on material. So we could just go Hardened Scales, attack, sack Damping Sphere, and hope that they're incapable of going off. Cause that leaves us with the best chance of like rebuilding. We can just play a Ravager on our next turn. Cause right now if we claim the KCI, it's just not even that good. Because they get to get back something. It's pretty nasty. So yeah, I think I like the Hardened Scales play the best, actually. And just when they block, sack. Oh wait, we have to sack two things. Shoot. To have our Ravager survive. Okay, I don't like this play anymore, but we've committed to it. I guess I just pass now and hope that we survive a turn, but it's not looking good. Yeah, KCI is a powerful and resilient deck. Engineered Explosives is really good. They've gotten to recur it a lot of times. Because now, yeah, any one drop, they can just go one drop, EE, pop it, and then they're off to the races. Okay, so they can go Ichor Wellspring, crack it for mana. Yeah, this is going to be tough to beat. Because now they're going to get back EE. And they just have six cards in hand. Dang. So our opponent did actually overpay here for EE. One trick you can do with cards like Damping Sphere is they wanted to pay 2 mana total for EE. They could have used one colorless, or sorry, 2 colored mana, announced EE for 1, and paid a red and a green for it. That's like a legal play you can make, which is a little unusual, but definitely works. So something to watch out for when you end up playing against Damping Spheres is that you can do that. I also probably should have brought in Tormod's Crypt. We're kind of getting punished for that, huh? Okay. They have Ancient Stirrings for Mirror Retriever, which is really good. Actually, nope, that's a deterministic loop, right? Because they can play the Retriever, sack it, get back a 1 and a Scrap Trawler. Yeah. All right, we're dead. Yeah, I don't know. That was a really tough game. Felt like there might have been something we could have done differently, but boy, that was tough. Anyway, thanks for watching, guys. Be sure to like, share, and subscribe if you enjoyed the video, and we'll be back next week.